من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا وبعد فإن أصدق الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد قال الله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اركعوا واسجدوا واعبدوا ربكم وافعلوا الخير لعلكم تفلحون. Allah says towards the end of Surah Al-Hajj, O you who believe, perform the ruku', irka'u, wasjudu, and the sujood, wa'budu rabbakum, and worship your Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala singles out those parts of the salah, those acts of worship that symbolize true submission to Him. So He says, irka'u, make the ruku', wasjudu, and make the sujood, wa'budu rabbakum, and worship your Lord, وَفْعَلُوا الْخَيْرَ, and do all types of good so that you would be successful. We notice in the verse following that, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ. So after mentioning all of those acts of worship and doing all types of good so that you will be successful, Allah says, and strive in the path of Allah, حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ, with the type of striving that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worthy of. There's a type of repetition. Allah didn't just say, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ. He said, and strive, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ, with the striving that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worthy of. This is like Allah saying, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. Not just fear Allah and be mindful of Allah, but fear and be mindful of Allah, حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ, with the mindfulness and the fear that He is worthy of. So the repetition is there for emphasis. And that striving and that mindfulness of Allah, it has to be فِي اللَّهِ. وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ. It has to be purely for Allah. Purely intended on pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we all know, when we try to commit ourselves to Allah, the shaitan comes to us from many different angles. He comes to us from every weakness that he knows that we have. He comes to us and he tries to push us back. And he tries to take us back to where we were before we started trying to commit ourselves to Allah. So if we're going to be successful in this path, then we have to be able to stop. And we have to be able to assess ourselves. We have to be able to re-evaluate ourselves and assess where we're going. Just like when you run a business or you run a school, every quarter you stop and you have an assessment. You stop and there's an evaluation. And we look and we see, what can we be doing differently? What can we do this year to make the business successful that we didn't do last year? What can we change about the curriculum, or maybe one of the staff members, that will make the education in our school better? We stop and we assess ourselves. And we put together a plan for how we should move forward. Similarly with our iman, for our akhirah, every quarter, we need to stop and we need to assess ourselves. What have I been doing for the last 3 months? What have I been doing good? And what can I do better? And what do I need to change? We have to be able to stop. And we have to be able to assess ourselves with our faith, just like we do in everything in this life if we want to be successful. And we see this example in the lives of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were always mindful. They never allowed themselves to lose focus of where they were headed. Uthman ibn Affan, They would see him with standing near the graveyards with tears flowing down his face. And as you know, in Al-Madina, the graveyard is very close to the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's easy to visit it all the time. It's easy for somebody to stop and to remind themselves all the time. So they would see him near the grave and tears would be flowing down his face, and they would say to him, Ya Uthman, you remind us about Jannah, and you remind us about the fire, and you remind us about the Akhirah all the time, but we don't see tears flowing down your face. But when you're near the grave, or you're talking about the grave, we see tears flowing down your face. He said, that's because my companion, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he died, he said to me, إِنَّ الْقَبْرَ أَوَّلُ مَنَازِلِ الْآخِرَةِ فَمَنْ نَجَى مِنْهُ فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَيْسَرَ مِنْ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَنْجُ مِنْهُ فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَشَدُّ مِنْ. He said, because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he died, he said to me that the grave is the first stage of the stages of the Akhirah. Whoever passes that stage successfully, whoever is rewarded in their grave by Allah, then every stage that comes after that is going to be easier and better than it. But whoever does not pass that stage successfully, meaning whoever is punished in their grave, then every stage that comes after it is going to be worse and more difficult and more painful than that stage. He never forgot those words that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him. And every time he saw the graves, he remembered the Akhirah. How often do we stop and remember the Akhirah? How long have you been on this journey back to Allah? For 50 years, for 60 years, for 70 years, you've been on a journey headed back to Allah. How many times did you stop and remember the destination of this journey that you're on, like Uthman radiallahu anhu stopped? Even if you haven't done much in the past, then as Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad said, even if you haven't done much in the past, he said, أحسن فيما بقي يغفر لك ما مضى. Do your best, correct what remains in your life, and what was past, Allah will forgive what was past. Take control of what you still have control over. Control the part of your life that is still remaining, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive what passed. Anas ibn Malik, he said, that I once saw Umar ibn al-Khattab when he was Amir al-Mu'mineen, when he was the leader of the believers. I saw him standing in a garden and he was repeating something to himself over and over. So I went close so I could see what he was saying. And when I came close to him, I saw that he had raised his hands up and he was saying to Allah, he was reminding himself. He was reminding himself. He was saying, Uffin laka ya Umar. وَاللَّهِ لَتَتَّقِيَنَّ اللَّهِ أَوْ لَيُعَذِّبَنَّكَ اللَّهِ. He was saying to himself, he was evaluating and assessing and holding himself accountable, and he was saying, O Umar, you will either fear Allah and have taqwa and be mindful of Allah, or Allah is going to punish you. And he was repeating it over and over. And this is Umar ibn al-Khattab, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the man responsible for the expansion of the Muslim lands. The man that's recognized by Muslims and non-Muslims alike for his justice, for his equality. The man that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ himself called Al-Faruq. The one that Allah will use to separate between truth and falsehood. He's the one that will separate between truth and falsehood. This is the title that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ himself gave him. The man that the companion said about, we've been honored and we've been proud and we've never feared being Muslim since the day that Umar ibn al-Khattab entered Islam. Despite all of that, he wasn't satisfied with his accomplishments. He wasn't saying to himself, I'm going to enter Jannah. He didn't feel like it was a guarantee. Rather, he was reflecting. And he was reminding himself to be mindful of Allah. And we have to stop. And we have to reassess ourselves. And we have to remind ourselves, ask ourselves, is this going to be another year? Another year that I'm still not perfecting the five salah. Another year that I'm still not paying the zakat. That I'm holding stingily onto that wealth. Refusing to pay the zakat. The part of the wealth that's due, I'm still not paying it. Another year that I still haven't spoken to my brother, my sister, my mother. That I'm cutting the ties of kinship for no good reason. Another year that I'm still indulged in all of those desires, lost in the ocean of desires that's out there. Umar ibn al-Khattab, he wasn't satisfied with his accomplishments. And he kept on reminding himself during the last Hajj, during his last Hajj, radiallahu anhu, as narrated, as recorded in the Muwatta of Imam Malik, Ibn Abbas said that Umar asked me to go bring him some water for the wudu. So I brought it, and he made wudu and he prayed 2 rak'at. And after he did that, he raised his hands up to Allah and he said, Allahumma tala umri wa da'ufat quwwati wa tasa'at ra'iyati fatawaffani ilayka ghayra mufarrat. He said, O Allah, my life, I've lived a long life and my strength is weakening, and this ummah that I'm responsible for, that I'm the leader of, is growing bigger and bigger. So, O Allah, do not allow me to return to you while I'm not fulfilling my responsibility. Then he made a dua that really caught Ibn Abbas's attention. He said, وَتَوَفَّنِي شَهِيدًا فِي مَدِينَةِ نَبِيِّكَ. He said, O Allah, and make me die as a shaheed, as a martyr, in the city of your Prophet. So Ibn Abbas, he found this strange. How can he die a shaheed in al-Madinah? He would have to go out with the army. He would have to go out to the battlefield if he was going to die a shaheed. So he found this dua to be strange. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua of those who fulfill the conditions. For those who fulfill, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَجَاهِدُ فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِهِ. For those who fulfill those conditions, Allah answers the dua. And only weeks after his last Hajj, while leading Salatul Fajr, and we know the story, while leading Salatul Fajr in the Prophet's Masjid in Al-Madinah, just feet away from where the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ had been buried in his home, he was stabbed to death by Abu Lu'lu Al-Majusi, the fire worshipper. And he died while leading Salatul Fajr in the Prophet's Masjid. And then he was buried right next to his two companions, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua of those who fulfill the conditions of the dua being answered. He lived and he never forgot his duty to Allah. And he never lost his concern to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause us to have that self-reflection and to fulfill that duty and never to lose our mindfulness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our lives. أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على نبيه المصطفى. After hearing those examples, brothers and sisters in Islam, on the other hand of that, there are some people that will reach the Day of Judgment with no good to show for their entire life of striving, with absolutely no good to show. As in the agreed upon hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِنَّهُ لَيَأْتِي الرَّجُلُ الْعَظِيمُ السَّمِينُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ لا يزن عند الله جناح بعوضة. That a man would come with a great physique, a man of great stature, a man that was somebody in this life, that people probably admired in this life, but on the Day of Judgment, he will not have the value of جناح بعوضة. He will not have the value of a wing of a fly, not a fly, not the whole fly. But his value in the sight of Allah will not even be the wing of a fly. He will not have any value in front of Allah. A person of great stature in this dunya. A person that other people wanted to be like. That other people admired. He comes to the Day of Judgment having absolutely no value. Having done nothing at all to prepare himself for that day. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ. O you who believe, fear Allah, be mindful of Allah, and let every nafs, let every person think about, reflect upon what it has put forward for tomorrow. What have you put forward for tomorrow? What have you put forward for your meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And self-reflection teaches us not to blame other people. Not to blame other people. we see in the political speeches that for every problem, there's somebody else to be blamed. It's because of those people. It's because of that type of people. It's because of this individual. Nobody's willing to take the blame. Nobody's willing to stand up and say, I'm the one that needs to make changes. I'm the one that needs to correct my own faults and mistakes. And it's not easy to be real with ourselves. It's not easy to be real with ourselves. But we have to stop and we have to be able to say, I'm going to leave the people that are bringing me down. I'm going to stay away from that environment that I know is not doing me any good. If you live making the five salah, then there's a very good chance that you're going to meet Allah that way. But if you live yourself and you're not even making the five daily salah, then what are the chances that you're giving yourself of having a good end in this life and meeting Allah with a good end? Why don't you pack your family in the car and bring them to Salatul Isha? Make the masjid part of your life. Bring your family to the masjid. You'll be doing something better for your children. Wallahi, you'll be doing something better for your children than if you were to take them on a vacation and spend thousands and thousands of dollars. If you made it your habit that every night you put them in the car and you bring them to the masjid for Salatul Isha, so that they see Islam around them, so that they feel Islam around them. You will be doing better for yourself if you did that than all of the money that you spend somewhere else. Before the time comes, before it's too late, and they grow up and they don't know who they are, and they don't know what to believe, and they don't know what their religion is. And then at that point it might be too late for you to get through to them. It might be too late for you to try to teach them at that point. We have to make those changes and we have to stop and assess ourselves. Look at yourself. Look at your family. Stop and look at your children. What are they upon? Be real with yourself. Don't just assume the best. What are your children really upon in their lives? Stop. Look. Think. And reflect upon your situation. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rectify all of our affairs and to guide us and our families to the straight path. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم ثبتنا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة اللهم ثبتنا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.